Oh, well, good morning, everybody. Let me say what a great pleasure it is for me to be here this morning. And thanks so much for that, I must say, overly generous introduction. It's a real pleasure to be in such a beautiful environment and on a panel with such distinguished collaborators. So thanks to everyone, especially Christina, for organizing my visit. And I do hope that everybody has an interesting and enjoyable day as it unfolds today. Well, my starting point is a kind of global one. I've been practicing social scientist for several decades now, you could say. And I have to say that in all of that time, I've never found the world as opaque. I've never found the world as difficult to read as it is now. We used to think, as social scientists, that the more we got to know about the world, the more we could confidently walk into the future. But it doesn't look like that at all. The future to us, I think, looks very difficult to think through. This is a kind of backdrop to what I want to say, because I want to suggest to you that we're in a kind of deep structural transition in world society whose characteristics we haven't yet fully grasped. I think I was perhaps, might even have been the first person in the world to use the term globalization many years ago. And of course, it's taken on a career of its own. But we need to think that it's not a simple unfolding process, that it goes across many step changes, and one of those step changes is probably happening now. I just was looking at the newspaper coming across in the plane, and there was an account of an IMF meeting in New York. And some of the best economists in the world were at that meeting, or either advised the IMF or are members of the IMF on a regular basis. And it's very interesting to read their discourse, because what they were saying was that as economists, we no longer understand the world economy. We just don't know what is going to happen next in the world economy. All we can say, they seem to conclude, and this is only a newspaper report, I didn't hear the original speeches, of course, all we can say is that things will be different from how they were for the past 20 or 30 years, because some of the basic premises on which the world economy is built turn out not in fact to be the case. So that in some way we've systematically misunderstood the world we've created. We don't have to start again, but in my view, we need a huge effort of intellectual reconstruction at this point, which would go into many areas. I think President Sampaio is going to concentrate mainly on the European Union, but my point would be that for us living here in Europe, you cannot simply start and finish with the European Union. We are talking here of much broader trends than those simply located in Europe. So, you know, this is a time when an anti-European party has been doing very well in the British elections last night. I'm a strong pro-European, and I would say to everyone here, don't make the mistake of blaming Europe simply for the issues which confront us. Don't make the mistake of just blaming the euro for the issues which confront us, because if you do, none of us actually will find a viable solution. Now, what's happening in economics, as it were, is also happening in democracy across the world. That is, we seem to be entering a new phase quite different from the past. until fairly recently, there was a fairly confident set of assertions about democracy, especially informed by writers such as Samuel Huntingdon, who, you know, was a kind of confidence about the future. People were writing about the fourth wave of democracy. Democracy is like waves which come in, and each wave includes more people in the world than before. So the fourth wave of democracy saw democracy spreading across Latin America, spreading across Africa, spreading across parts of Asia. And some people took to calling the Arab Spring the fifth wave of democracy. But if you actually look what's happening across the world, you can see that much of this has turned sour. It is not only in Europe that we start thinking of a range of crises surrounding democracy and democratization. There's a good book on this, speaking as an academic, which anyone is interested in this audience, is by a guy called John Kurtlancic. You don't need his name, really. The book is called Democracy in Retreat, Democracy in Retreat. And it charts what he sees as the problematic nature of democracy around the world. Democracy, he says, and I agree with him, is in trouble all around the world. And this is a situation quite different from the recent past because, as we know, democracy is now in trouble in its heartlands. That is the difference, I think. Democracy is in trouble in the areas that most people took to be the core of democratic systems, democratic political systems. These include the United States, where many people now see the United States as dysfunctional in terms of taking effective decisions, which would reflect the mandate of the political process. Whereas in Europe, you have the rise of extremism in the case of the Tea Party, and you have many, many problems such as the dominance of corporations over the American political process. Which means if you take it out and scrutinize it, it's supposed to be the home of democracy, but very, very serious structural problems there. We all know, we're all conscious living in Europe, of the massive divisions that have opened up across our continent. We're all conscious of the rise of populist parties and what happened last night in the UK with the rise of UKIP, the United Kingdom Independence Party, was something like a massive defeat for the incumbent government, the Tory government. UKIP, to put it charitably, does not have a lot of well-defined policies. It's like other populist parties in Europe, but it's a very big secular change in British society that happened last night, and very, very linked in this case to people's feelings about the European Union. If we look across the world, we can see the issues that we have in Europe are, however, not so different from elsewhere. The same issue with the problem of trust everywhere. It is more or less universal in the so-called democratic countries. The issue of respect for political leaders, more or less the same everywhere. The issue of apparently the shrinking power of parliaments, the same more or less throughout the democratic world. That's the reason why I would insist strongly that when we discuss these issues in the context of Europe, we should not only talk about Europe itself. And sort of en passant, I would say that I don't completely agree with the head tag of this conference. I mean, there are local solutions to global issues, but I think we also need global solutions to them, to some of these issues. And I think they involve a kind of new look at how we're going to control the world financial and economic systems. So I think we need actually certainly a mix of those two approaches. Well, this leads me to suggest that in the area of democratic politics, we really do need new thinking. And it won't be enough just to sort of counter populism in Europe. We need as it were, some fairly deep structural rethinking. I mean, I haven't time to talk about these in detail, but I just mention 3 points about this. First of all, I think we should drop Western arrogance about democracy. By Western arrogance, I mean the idea that democracy originated in Europe and the United States, and it's our business to take it to the rest of the world. Again, for anyone of an academic turn of mind, there is a terrific book on these issues by an author called John Keane, Australian author, K-E-A-N-E. A massive tome, so big that you couldn't carry it into this lecture hall without a cart following you behind, but the study of democracy. And what Keane shows is that democracy certainly does not just have European origins, that democracy has universal origins, that indeed it was Muslims who first brought to Southern Europe some core ideas of democracy, where democracy means public involvement, where democracy means accountability, where democracy means the chance of influencing the decisions that affect your lives. And Keane shows as universal origins, not just Western origins. To me, very important, because it means we're not just on a mission of introducing to the rest of the world something which we've pioneered here. We're in the middle of all this. We're in the middle of a global dialogue about how you produce accountability, how you produce leadership when no one really trusts their leaders, and so forth. So we need a much wider and restructured dialogue. Second, this dialogue should be with some of the other major cultures of the world. And again, forgive me for talking like an academic all the time, but there's a very, very interesting debate between the leading Chinese political thinker of the moment, Zhang Weiwei, who was actually educated by Samuel Huntington in America, and who wrote an important book upon the state of China and its contribution to world civilization. Very different take on the origins of not just of world society, but of democracy from that ordinarily offered in the West. And he had this, it's called the China Wave, by the way, the China Wave, W-A-V-E, if anyone's interested, which I hope people will be. There's a very interesting discussion between Zhang Weiwei and Francis Fukuyama, which took place a couple of years ago, with Fukuyama defending Western democracy, as it were, and Weiwei saying, well, look, here's another civilization with a different trajectory. Maybe you can learn something from us. And it's great fun to read, because what Weiwei says, you know, Fukuyama is going on about no freedom in China and so forth. And Weiwei says, you know, it's not just freedom, it's accountability. What accountability do you have in the United States? Look, the bankers have ruined the world. Your bankers have ruined your world, and no one's called them to account. What kind of accountability is that? See, I think we need that kind of dialogue, and it would be a rich source of thinking for us. Third and finally, it's entirely obvious that new electronic media are behind many of these changes. And to me, I don't think any of us have really got to terms with what the new electronic media mean for our lives. It is just completely mind-blowing, the relationship between you as an individual with your mobile phone, which is a mobile computer, in fact, and this unbelievable global system of communication. Quite unbelievable that human beings could ever have created that. It's something new in human history. It's not surprising if we don't fully understand that either. But it seems clear that, you know, that's behind two interconnected sorts of processes, the rise of new technologies of communication, not just the internet, but the wider system of technological communication. On the one hand, an opening up process, obviously, to the general population, which places in mind, in doubt, the mechanisms of representative democracy. And on the other hand, all sorts of vicious forms of hatred and so forth, which surge across the internet. These two things sort of merge with one another. And you couldn't have the rise of UKIP, for example, without the internet, I think. Many such populist movements make very wide use of internet technology, as do terrorist groups. See, my concluding argument would be that most people who write about the new media are looking in the wrong place, though, to try to see how we could repair democracy. Most people who work on the new media are suggesting, well, the most important thing is to complement the old institutions, which obviously we still need, the rule of law, the rule of parliament, and so forth, with a new kind of electronic democracy, which would be a kind of participatory democracy. The main trouble with that, as I would see it, is no one has found a way in which that could work. Now, of course, it's possible that it might do, but I think in Europe and elsewhere, we should look in a different direction. We should look in the direction of an altogether new level of transparency, which the new media have brought about, because the new media leave traces everywhere. So when we see, for example, key figures in Germany and France, many other countries being shown to be guilty of corruption, that's an example of the new transparency, I think. In my mind, one of the main things we have to do in world society is close down tax havens, because tax havens are taking a lot of the resources which belong to our populations and which should be part of our welfare states. Some people might have seen the publication of the International Consortium of Journalists in the United States, which traced the information through a whole range of tax havens. Very revelatory. This is the first time, I think, that the world seriously will take action against tax havens. But now we're going to live in a kind of goldfish bowl. And, you know, this is very bad as well as good sides, because there's no privacy anymore. But it does mean, I think, that we can initiate a process of what I would call the democratizing of democracy. The democratizing of democracy means eliminating the problems and the limitations of traditional Western bureaucratic systems. One of these is simply corruption. I mean, you should only look what's happened in the UK. You've got an opening up. Politicians were found to be corrupt. The police were found to be corrupt. The media were found to be corrupt. The bankers were found to be corrupt. This is laying on slightly heavily. But all the institutions of British society have become opened up. And I see this in the end as a positive process, and a possible movement anyway towards the restoration of democracy, because I still think democracy in a high-tech, globalized, information-rich world still needs the traditional institutions. There is no replacement in sight for a representative democracy. There is no replacement in sight for an elected democracy. There is no replacement in sight for an independent judiciary. There is no replacement in sight for the rule of law. We must sustain these things, but I think on a different level to the past. Thank you very much for your attention.